In this video, we're going to prove the parallel axis theorem, and then we're going to demonstrate with three examples how to apply the parallel axis theorem to compute moments of inertia. So in our picture, we have just some arbitrary rigid body with a mass of big M, and we've labeled its center of mass and a rotation axis. So the rotation axis in this picture is pointing out of the screen, and we're imagining twisting this rigid body about that rotation axis, and we get a moment of inertia that we call ICM for center of mass. Now, the whole point of the parallel axis theorem is that we want to compute the moment of inertia about another axis away from the center of mass. And we're going to call this moment of inertia I parallel. And in the picture, we've separated that by a distance of d from the center of mass. Now, one thing we should understand just qualitatively is that I parallel should be a bigger moment of inertia than I center of mass, because more of the mass is farther away from the rotation axis if we choose this I parallel rotation axis. And the other thing I want to make really clear about this new rotation axis is that it is parallel to the rotation axis we originally had going through the center of mass. When we talk about I parallel, we're also talking about a rotation axis that points directly out of the screen. And if our two rotation axes aren't parallel, then we can't use the parallel axis theorem. So as it turns out, the moment of inertia about this parallel axis is given by the moment of inertia about the center of mass plus big M times d squared. In other words, we're adding in a term that acts as if we have an extra point mass of big M located at a distance of d from this parallel axis. Now, to start setting up the proof of the parallel axis theorem, we're going to have to take a look at a picture that I usually refer to as a particle swarm. And this is really typical of classical mechanics proofs. If we're trying to prove something about a rigid body, we can always just visualize it as a swarm of individual point masses, because any continuous mass can be just chopped up into point masses. And anything we prove about this collection of point masses will naturally also apply to a continuous rigid body. So we've visualized this swarm of particles. There's actually 10 of them in the picture, and the first 9 of them are labeled 1 through 9. And then notice here, one of them is labeled as MI, and that's meant to be just an arbitrary mass sitting at an arbitrary location, and that's the one we're going to focus on for our proof. And so I want to start with a little reminder of how you compute the moment of inertia of a collection of point masses. So we've chosen our center of mass as our rotation axis. And the moment of inertia is given by the sum over all the masses. That's as I goes from 1 to n. We're just imagining this thing has been chopped up into n point masses. Of the product of each individual point mass multiplied by its distance from the origin squared. And those ri squareds are the magnitudes of position vectors which point from the chosen origin, which for now is the center of mass, to the location of each object. Now, the second thing I want to get done before we really get into the proof is that deep in the proof of this theorem, there's a moment where it might seem like I'm pulling a rabbit out of a hat, and I'd rather just get the rabbit out of the hat right at the beginning, so we're ready to recognize this thing when we're deep in the proof. And what I'm talking about is a fact about the center of mass position. So recall that in general, the center of mass position for a collection of point masses is given by 1 over the total mass times the sum of each position vector multiplied by the mass that's at that location. So that's the sum of mi times ri vector. But if we're computing the center of mass vector and we have an origin at the center of mass, well, that means the center of mass vector has to come out to 0. And just a quick side note here, this is a vector, so that really should be written as vector 0. So the point is that deep within our proof, we're going to discover this expression, the sum of mi times ri, where those position vectors are with respect to the center of mass, and we automatically know that sum is going to vanish. That sum in general is equal to big M multiplied by the center of mass position vector, but that's 0 if we're in the center of mass coordinate system. Okay, so there's our rabbit, just got it out in the open, and we're ready to start our formal proof. So again, the point of the parallel axis theorem is to try to compute the moment of inertia about a new axis parallel to the original axis passing through the center of mass. So there's our new rotation axis. Both of these axes point out of the screen, making them parallel. And we want to compute the moment of inertia with respect to that new origin. That means we need position vectors pointing from that new origin to every single point mass in the collection, but I'm just going to highlight the arbitrary point mass mi. Note that I called the position vector ri prime just to distinguish it from the position vectors relative to the center of mass. And what we realize here is we can express ri prime as a vector sum that refers back to the center of mass location. So we start by pointing from our new axis back to the center of mass rotation axis. And the magnitude of that vector is d. That's the separation between the two axes for the parallel axis theorem. Now we can point from the center of mass to the location of mi. And again, we called that ri with no prime on it. So that's just the position vector with respect to the center of mass coordinate system. So we can see that ri prime is given by d vector added to ri vector. So that's going to give us the connection between these two axes. And we're going to start out by writing down the moment of inertia in the parallel coordinate system. So just using the definition of moment of inertia for a collection of point masses, that's mi times ri prime squared. So the magnitudes of the position vectors all squared. And now we replace each ri prime with its representation as a vector sum. So that vector sum is again d vector plus ri vector, and we need the magnitude of that squared. And then we recall that to find the squared magnitude of a vector, we just have to dot it into itself with the dot product. So now we have the sum of the mi's multiplied by d plus ri dotted into itself. But the dot product is distributive. So when we start distributing the dot product here, we're going to get a d dotted into d out of that as our leading term, and ri dotted into ri as our final term. And then we have a cross term where we have d dotted into r and r dotted into d. But the dot product is also commutative, so we can write that as 2 times d dotted into ri. And note that I've also used here the fact that dotting d into itself gives me the magnitude of d squared, and dotting ri into itself gives me the magnitude of ri squared. So these first two terms are kind of the easy pieces to deal with. And then I have this dot product between d and ri that's going to be a little more interesting. So in the next step, I just split this into three different sums. In the first sum, I have the sum of mi times d squared. Well, with d being a constant, we can just factor that out of the sum in the next step. In my second term, I have the sum of all the mi's times ri squared, and we recognize that from the definition of the moment of inertia about the center of mass. That's all that is the moment of inertia about the center of mass. In the third sum, I factored the 2 out of it while I was going, and I end up with terms that look like mi multiplied by d dotted into ri. Now that d is not changing with the index I. In fact, if we visualize this sum in expanded form, every single term is going to have that same d in it. It's just dotted into a different ri in each individual term. So now we can apply the distributivity of the dot product again, and we just pull that vector d out of the sum and write this as 2d dotted into the sum of mi times ri. And this is the moment where I pull a rabbit out of a hat, right? But I already showed you the rabbit. Whenever you see this expression, the sum of mi times ri vector, you know that's going to be the total mass multiplied by the center of mass vector. And this is a really common occurrence in these formal proofs of classical mechanics theorems. Well, in this particular case, these ri's were measured with respect to the center of mass origin of coordinates. So our center of mass position is 0, and this sum vanishes. So now all we're left with for the moment of inertia about the parallel axis is the moment of inertia with respect to the center of mass plus the total mass multiplied by d squared. And that's our proof of the parallel axis theorem. So next we're going to take a look at a few examples of how to apply this theorem. In the first example, we're asked to use the moment of inertia for a thin rod rotated about a center. And again, that's critical. We're always referring to a moment of inertia about the center of mass of the object. And we recall that that's equal to 1/12 ml squared, and I'll post a link to the video where that was derived using physical integration. Okay, and what we're asked to do is compute the moment of inertia for this thin rod rotated about one end. So there's our parallel axis at one end of the rod. It has a distance of L over 2 from the center of mass. And now we just apply the parallel axis theorem, I parallel. is equal to the moment of inertia about the center of mass plus md squared, where d is the separation between the two parallel axes. So the moment of inertia about the center of mass was 1/12 ml squared. And then d is L over 2, so I need to square that. Now each of these terms has an ml squared in it, and I'm going to move the constants out in front. So I have 1/12 from the first term and 1/4 after the squaring for the second term times ml squared. And 1/4 is 3/12, and if I add 1/12 and 3/12, I get 4/12, but that reduces to 1/3. So I end up with 1/3 ml squared. And this agrees with the result we got by using physical integration, and I'll post a link to that video as well. Okay, next we're going to look at a thin ring, and we're reminded in the problem, the moment of inertia of a thin ring about its center, in other words, about its rotation axis, is given by mr squared. So now we want the moment of inertia about one edge of this ring. And this is a moment of inertia that might be relevant to a real lab activity, because you can take a thin ring and hang it on a horizontal rod and watch it oscillate. And the period of those oscillations depends on the moment of inertia about one edge of the ring, not the center of the ring. So we put our parallel axis into the diagram. And again, we apply the parallel axis theorem. So we have I center of mass plus m times d squared, where d is the distance between the two parallel axes. So the moment of inertia about the center of mass is given by mr squared. And then d, the separation distance between the two axes, is just the same thing as the radius of the ring. So I get another mr squared. And this gives me the result 2 mr squared. And we've got the moment of inertia of a ring rotating about one edge. In the final example, we're just going to do an analogous thing for a solid sphere. So we're reminded of the moment of inertia of a solid sphere, and that's 2/5 mr squared. And I think I actually have 3 videos of derivations of this fact using different methods of physical integration, so I'll just throw one of those links up at the top. And what we're trying to find in this problem is the moment of inertia about an axis that's tangent to the surface of the sphere. So we pop in a parallel axis here that's just barely touching the surface of the sphere, but it is parallel to the original rotation axis that we showed in the diagram. And we apply the parallel axis theorem, and we put in the moment of inertia with respect to the center of mass, that's 2/5 mr squared. And we add to that m times d squared, where d is the distance between the two parallel axes, which again is just the radius of the sphere. Each of these terms has an mr squared in it, so we'll put the constants out in front, 2/5 plus 1, and then this is multiplied by big M r squared. Now just simplifying those constants, 1 is 5/5, so 5/5 and 2/5 gives me 7/5 mr squared. And we've got the moment of inertia of a solid sphere rotating about a tangent to the surface. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.